Sometimes, letters have little extra bits added on here and there, and those are called accents. One accent you've probably seen before is this one, where two dots appear over a vowel letter. You've got this in French, in Spanish, in Swedish, Finnish, Catalan, German, Turkish, Pinyin, even in English, though it's usually kind of optional there. In some of these languages, this isn't considered an accent per se, rather being seen as forming its own individual letter, but we can still see it as being created from the base letter's glyph, plus this two dots glyph. Now, if you take, for example, this letter U with two dots as seen in the German Mutter, or the French aigu, you'll see that these are identical. They have the same Unicode code, they are written identically in any given handwriting style. But what if I told you that they are completely different, not just by what language they're in, but in name, in origin, and in use? These accents may look the same, but they have nothing to do with each other. What you're more likely to have heard about this kind of mark is that it's called an Umlaut. But technically that only applies to these words here. Umlaut is a German word made up of two parts, a prefix meaning over again or in another way, quite similar to re in English, and laut, meaning sound. An Umlaut is a sound in another way, and we can see this if we compare the three letters that can have an Umlaut in German with and without this accent on. Compare the words schon, meaning already, and schön, meaning beautiful, Mutter, ah, er. Did you hear that? The vowel sound changed with the addition of the Umlaut. There was a sound another way. More precisely, the idea is that the vowel is supposed to become fronted with the addition of the Umlaut, so that you have back-front vowel pairs of otherwise similar vowels. So it isn't just a random other sound that the Umlauted letter is making, it's related to the original sound. The Umlaut diacritic dates back to the Middle Ages. Back then, the Germans made a habit of taking digraphs, where two letters are used to represent one single sound in the spoken language, and placing the second letter of this digraph on top of the first. So, when we look at old names like Goethe, we see that the OE digraph here represents that sound. Then, they put that E in superscript on top of that O. Elegant, isn't it? Already by the late Middle Ages, that E was sometimes being replaced by a double dot for the sake of efficiency in handwritten documents. And through the early modern period, the superscript E slowly died out, disappearing first from handwriting and then from print, being replaced with the modern Umlautzeichen. It's this notation that's been loaned into other languages like Swedish and Turkish, and romanizations like Pinyin. But take those dots over aigu again. The letter U is usually pronounced this way in French, like in lu, tu, etc. So there aren't any louts being ummed here. No, this mark here is called a diaeresis, and what it tells the reader isn't to change the letter's sound, but to pronounce it in the first place. See, French for whatever reason, has a lot of silent letters, and just this on its own would be pronounced egg, not aigu. The diaeresis marks where a letter should be pronounced separately from its environment. Another example of this would be the word naive in both French and its usual spelling in English. Instead of being nerve or naive, with those letters forming a digraph or diphthong respectively, the I is pronounced on its own in a new syllable, naive. This diacritic goes all the way back to the Hellenistic period in ancient Greece, with the trema being used on these vowels here to show that they were opening a new word, as word spacing wasn't yet used, or also to show that a vowel formed a syllable by itself. And from there, it made its way into Latin-based scripts. English used to use this accent a lot more in the past, and a few set publications still insist on using it, which some people call pretentious, but I call showy. You might have seen it in words like re-enter, to tell us that it isn't re-enter, but rather should have those two E vowels pronounced separately. So if you're going to take anything away from this video, apart from being able to pedantically correct people when they call the dots in naive and umlaut, now you know why cooperate used to be spelt like this.